Hey, what's up, guys? Welcome to OGF Radio, the official podcast of the Moods and Cubes, where we talk about games, movies, TV, and comics. My name is Migs, and with me is Emil.
What's up?
So, yeah, I guess we're back after our two back episodes,
yeah.
Special this
yeah.
week.
Back-to-back episodes with Robert.
Yeah, so, Well, now it's just back to business, and Robert's not with us.
Robert's back out of business.
It's just another awesome Tuesday podcast with yours truly and Emil.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, what's up with you? I mean, anything interesting that's happened this week?
Well, this week they released the new full-on Batman vs. Superman trailer.
And it's shown in Jimmy Kimmel of all
talk shows. Well, it started out with like that little teaser after the mid-season finale for Gotham, where it shows they're calling it the nightmare scene. Yeah, well, that little bit of Batman's in like the underground. Then Superman like flies down and like unmasks him.
Yeah, that was a good teaser.
Yeah,
actually, that was for me. That's the actual trailer for me. that short teaser actually sums up, you know, how excited I was before the actual full trailer was shown during the Jimmy Kimmel episode.
Yeah.
It is. I know. Did you like the trailer? The new one?
The full-on trailer?
Yeah.
A little bit. I mean, it's great seeing it kind of happen, but I'm still kind of iffy. Kind of iffy. Iffy on it, because I feel like they kind of... Well, in a way, you kind of knew what was going to happen, but it felt like you got... They pretty much showed you what the movie was going to be. You know, like the twist.
Yeah, exactly. It's like they kind of spoiled everything.
Yeah, it's kind of already.
Well, not everything, but kind of the basic plot of the movie.
Yeah. Well, I mean, that could just be, you know, what we're going to be led to believe. But when we see it, it's actually going to be different. That's possible too, I think.
Yeah, I hope so. I mean, so far, from what we saw in the trailer, we saw, how Lex Luthor is going to act, like, which is kind of a clownish, I don't know. He seems clownish to me.
Oh, he's like Eisenberg. It is like kind of comedic, sort of comic relief-ish.
Yeah, it isn't what I actually expect him to kind of.
Well, I mean, they're depicting a younger Lex Luthor. So what if something happens to him? Well, I guess something that relates to him also losing his hair, but like later on he becomes, you know, more vindictive. Like he becomes more vengeful towards Superman and changes his personality, maybe.
And by the way, I think Lex's character here is actually Alexander. Which is Lex Luthor's son.
Yeah.
So it's not really Lex Luthor. He's not
Lex.
Original.
Lex.
Yeah.
That would be
probably that's why the change of personality.
Possible showing too. That trailer. Wait, wasn't Alexander? I feel like I've seen him in the comics.
Yeah, he's the one in Infinite Crisis, I guess.
And he's the one who wanted to kill Lex, right?
Yeah, I guess so. Probably. But yeah, other than that, the other main thing that they show in the trailer is Doomsday, which is... I honestly feel like it's not
Doomsday. I hope it's not Doomsday. Even though, like, every kind of sign tells you that...
It isn't.
Oh, it is?
Like, the horns are a bit smaller, but the way they're placed is actual Doomsday signature horns.
Yeah.
Probably this is like a first, not really a first, like one of the beginning stages of Doomsday, which is that he's not that powerful yet. Because in in the comics, Doomsday character is somewhat like he doesn't die. Instead, he just powers up whenever he gets defeated,
and then he comes back. So,
yep, and more powerful than ever. So probably what they're gonna do here is they are gonna introduce Doomsday to this movie and probably get him beat up by the Trinity, so that when he appears again in another Superman sequel, he'd be all
more powerful.
That's really good.
I hope it's not like, we do Man of Steel too, and then he just comes back. I feel like, no. I feel like he should come back like later on, like later in the game. You know what I mean? Like where it takes the entire Justice League to like try and beat him. I think that would be better if they were going to go that route.
Yeah, I guess. Actually, I was hoping for it to be Bizarro.
Honestly, oh, yeah.
Instead of Doomsday, because it was kind of logical.
Yeah, yeah.
Because he, like, I think I remember that Bizarro's from General Zod's remains also.
Yeah,
I mean, he's a byproduct of cloning General Zod gone wrong.
I actually would rather prefer that General Zod kind of becomes, well, not becomes, but like, yeah, you're right. Like having Bizarro as a first villain, I think would have been. I feel like I would have liked it more, because it feels like you're exploring the universe a little bit more.
Yeah. And honestly, really, it's just too soon for Doomsday for me.
Yeah.
I didn't like it. So, yeah, I mean, I think the only thing that I like about that trailer is, you know, probably some of the action scenes that are shown, especially in the one in the Middle East. There's some, I don't know, some flying creatures that we just saw.
Yeah.
In this trailer, like, I know what they are. I think, forgot the word, but they were called in the comics. But
did you actually, sorry, what now?
I'm sorry, what is it?
Oh, did you actually notice on the trailer? It's funny, because I was actually having a discussion about this last night with a friend at her birthday party. On the trailer, there is some sort of like winged creatures like flying around, and so there's also a little bit of rumor spreading that like what if Doomsday and Darkseid are actually like mixed together now.
Actually, that's what I was talking about. I mean, the one in the Middle East scene, I mean the desert scene, sorry. Is there spring like creatures that are flying around in the background? There are lots of them. And it's kind of a surprise that this is the only thing, I mean, this is the only time I noticed that. So yeah, it's kind of a mystery who are these thing features.
Yeah, I mean, well, there was also the thing that, you know, people were picking up on the toy labels during a more recent expo, and they saw the Middle East Batman action figure. Well, not Middle East. I keep saying Middle East now too.
Robert's
not even here. Oh wait, he's sexist. Yeah. But they're saying that the desert scene is supposed to be just like a dream sequence, because they called that Batman nightmare Batman. So, yeah. I mean, maybe it's like something they foresee in the future, is Batman psychic now? Like, he sees into the future, he dreams about it. It's kind of weird, though.
Nah, probably just a nightmare scene.
Yeah, maybe.
Something like in the actual teaser, right? The teaser before this trailer. Is, we all see Superman's all grumpy and bent.
He's all like pissed off.
Evil
look.
Yeah.
That's actually why I was hoping for Bizarro.
Really that Superman-ish.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, actually, I was pointing that to my friend, that, no, this is Bizarro, that's not Superman, it's Bizarro.
Yeah, like, that would have been nice, to be honest. What did you think of, you know, the characters, well, the actors slash characters, like, how they played them out? Like, I know we touched on, Alexander Luther, yeah, so far on the trailer.
I guess I'm good with Henry Cavill. I mean, he's already impressive. in the first one.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I guess the other guys, I haven't really paid much attention to. I guess Ben Affleck's Bruce is also good.
Mm-hmm.
But
it's a little snarky. A little bit snarky towards Clark.
I was actually hoping for a Boston accent from Ben Affleck, but
Ben Affleck.
It's okay.
Oh, man.
But I guess his Batman voice is a bit, I don't know, wonky.
Like,
but it's not that inaudible like Christian Bale's throat cancer Batman voice. But there's like this... There's this moment in the final scene where they do a little bit of a humor.
Mm-hmm. Oh bathroom. Yeah, I hated that.
It's kind of
it's out of place. It's out of place. Like
yeah, and
this movie is made to be such a serious, like it has like such a serious tone, and then they put that in. It's kind of weird.
It's kind of weird hearing Ben Affleck sound like, you know, the serious tone of Batman.
Oh yeah.
And then delivering that line that I thought it was you. Okay.
Yeah.
But I don't know. I mean, overall, I wasn't impressed by the trailer.
Wait, you weren't impressed?
I wasn't impressed by the trailer.
Mm.
No, I wasn't. I wasn't impressed by the trailer. I'm sorry.
Well, because you kind of just expect it to be grand.
Yeah,
right off the bat,
they kind of went overboard with what they want to show.
Yeah,
like there's a fan made edit going on in the internet.
I saw that.
The trailer
where they cut the end.
they cut the end. I mean, they actually show the
Trinity.
I think they moved the scene with Lex and Clark and Bruce talking to the end of the trailer.
Mm-hmm.
And they didn't show that stupid comedy banter.
I also hated like the end part where you know, it's just like the Trinity on screen.
Yeah.
It was just kind of like, it was really cheesy.
Yeah.
And
yeah,
it was like, okay, nothing's really happening. Like, it could have at least...
You know what? Sorry. I was thinking that DC just reactively decided to launch a new trailer because they were worried about Civil War.
Oh my god. Yeah, maybe.
Just because the Civil War trailer is pretty awesome. I mean, it was pretty, you know, it's pretty moving.
The Civil War is actually like it's moving up because like there's been a lot of buzz about Tom Holland's Spider-Man.
Yeah, it's a big deal. I mean,
yeah.
Spider-Man.
Mm-hmm.
And
they're saying how he's not just going to be like, you know, someone in the shadows or something. He's going to be like coming up front and center.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So yeah, probably DC panic. I mean, that's my story about it. I mean, that's what's going on in my head. That, oh, we got to do something about this.
Like, we got to do something. We got to bring something out.
Australia 3.
Honestly, like that. I feel like DC is in a position where the less that they put out
show,
it's the better it is for it, because then you kind of keep that mystery, whereas, you know, Marvel is used to, you know, their formula, they know it works for them. Yeah. But you know,
it's like they're, I think for me it's like Marvel's mashing it up, which is surprisingly effective.
Yeah,
but it keeps, you know, that kind of Incredibles vibe, family tone that you normally see with their movies.
Mm-hmm.
So
yeah.
So I don't know. You really can't blame DC for trying something different.
I still have like my reservations about this movie, though. I want it to be good. Like, don't get me wrong, but after the whole Man of Steel thing, like me rewatching it, I hated it. Well, I didn't like it the first time, but like the second time, I hated it even more because now I started like nitpicking on things.
Oh.
But I just hope that they don't have that kind of, you know, plot holes in this one. Because if this is supposed to set the stage for, well, basically that universe of the Justice League,
yeah,
then, you know, it has to be amazing.
Hopefully,
yeah.
we'll get that answer after a few months.
Hopefully. I guess we'll know. Maybe I should just like not me? Watch any trailers.
Is it May?
So, was that?
Yeah. Is it May? I think they're going to show it in May.
I think it's in May. Hold on.
Is it July?
Release date. March 25.
Oh, March. Yeah. So, I think it's like 4 months.
Is it?
Yeah, it's pretty... Yeah, it's pretty close. You just have to wait for 3 or 4 months.
It's like towards the end, so like 5 months.
Yeah.
More like 5 months. But you guys get it a week and ahead, in advance, so. Yeah.
Anyway, so I haven't watched any TV shows this week. Like, nothing.
Really? What have you been watching on?
I haven't watched The Flash, I haven't watched that. I didn't watch the crossover again. Yeah. The only thing I watched was One Punch Man.
Oh, you finally saw the episode?
Yeah. Oh, God.
What did you think?
That ending was... Oh, my God. Exactly what you guys described during the last episode. It was good. I mean, Women Riders were heroes.
Like the essence of a hero right there.
Yeah, I mean, it's good that you didn't spoil the
all the way to the end, right?
Second half, yeah, the second half, because what you just spoiled is just the first half of the episode. Which is what?
Yeah, it's like there's more.
I was expecting that you guys already spoiled like
the entire episode,
3/4 of the episode.
No,
yeah,
like it was more just like you know the major part that we were like reacting to, because like there was so much feels going on.
It's just the first part. God.
So much feels, but that punch though, that punch.
Yeah,
I told you that cleared out the rain.
When I watched that, I kind of rewind it like 3 times just to see how that animated.
Yeah,
it's glorious.
And it's just like it pushes the rain away. I was like, what? Yeah. Yeah, it's nuts. So, if you weren't watching in TV, what were you up to?
Yeah, I was playing games.
There you go.
I have 2 games that I bought last year. Like, literally, it was already a year ago since I last bought it. It was Witcher 2 and Dragon Age Inquisition. And I think I played those games probably the first month or two after I bought them, but I kind of have an on and off thing with these games. So I haven't really gotten the time to play it, fully.
Right.
Because of Counter-Strike and
other stuff happens.
So yeah. So this December, I vowed, I swore to myself that this is already 1 year, and we have to finish you.
Oh God!
So I first did Witcher 2, and wow, it was something. Like it was better than I expected it. I mean, this thing that I have a problem with Witcher 2 is that there's this moment in the game that I have really no motivation to finish it because I didn't like what's happening in the story.
For two?
Yeah, I mean, during the... Oh, God. Is this... I think it's during the first part of the Caedwin and Vergen War.
Okay.
Have you finished it again?
Nope.
Okay.
I have the game. I have the first one, the second one, and third one.
Okay. So yeah, so there's this arc, there's this story arc.
Okay.
That actually led you to this in the middle of this Caedwin Vergen Kingdoms War. And it was okay, but it was kind of meh. Like the story is kind of not really clicking on me because the previous story was actually good, but it left off with a cliffhanger.
Oh, okay.
Like this, like I'm talking about the story arc from within the game. Like, there's this what's this? It's like the previous arc have you slaying a giant vegetable, basically. There's this plot about a sorceress and an assassin of kings and stuff.
Okay.
And you already got to fight that assassin of kings.
Okay.
But after that, it was just swish. You're now in the middle of the war between Cadwin and Bergen. And that's where things got a bit slow, but as I played again, like, I think I stopped last March.
Mm-hmm.
Then I revisited it just this month ago. So I tried to kind of grind my way to the story. But the more I played the arc, the more I appreciate it.
Yeah, okay.
The better it got it. It went all Game of Thrones type of conspiracy within the kingdoms that is trying to wage war against each other. And there's this thing about witch exorcism type of plot going on in that story arc.
Okay.
Which is cool because there's a mystery to it again. This is why I like the Witcher games, because it's like they treat every quest or every story arc as a mystery or something. It involves mystery.
Right, like it's something you really have to explore in order to understand.
Yeah, it's why I appreciate the writers in this game.
Mm.
So after that arc, we went to the final arc, which is something like a gathering of mages to actually see the future of the kingdom, of that universe. So there's this kind of peace talks going on, and some plot stuff happened, and you're in the final battle with a dragon. and after that, it was so grindy. Like, I think I heard my game on that one, because my gear is kind of like two or three levels down the recommended level.
Yeah.
So there's a lot of trial and error on the last.
Just trying to like get through it.
Yeah, and I did. So it's kind of like.
I mean, I guess that's an achievement.
Endeavor. Yeah, I guess so.
An achievement.
Then
it's funny because go ahead.
Yeah. No, I'm just saying that after the dragon battle, which is sort of like the final battle, there's an epilogue that went on to explain what happened after the dragon battle. And you get the chance to actually meet the Assassin of Kings again.
Okay.
And finish what you started. So, because this character is actually related to the hero, Geralt, because he knows him.
Mm-hmm.
And in this sequel, Geralt's kind of having an amnesia.
Okay. Oh, so, yeah.
So the Assassin of Kings actually has an idea of who Geralt was and what he was doing before he got the amnesia. So after that, there's a choice whether you would fight him to the death or just leave him be.
Mm-hmm.
And I chose to fight him to the death because it was a bit of a troll in the whole game. So I killed him, and that's it. That's the game. And it's kind of a cliffhanger ending also, because the ending is kind of, what do you call this? It's related to the third one.
Like what happens on the third one, like how it starts.
Yeah. So in the end, you never get to see Yennefer, which is a drab. But yeah, you get to see Yennefer, the Wild Hunt, anyway.
So
I'll have to Yennefer. See once I got my hands on the third game, which is I said bye because I already finished these two games.
It's funny because were mentioning Witcher 2 just now, or like the plot, it kind of sounds like Dragon Age Origins for some reason.
Yeah.
Like the story about the mages and like going up against like a dragon in the end. I was Dragon Age?
They have similarities when it comes to, how the mages are treated like shit or indifferent in those games.
They they basically just hate them because they don't know how to control their shit.
Yeah. And yeah, speaking of Dragon Age Inquisition, I just finished it just right now. Like right now.
Like right now, before this podcast.
Yeah, 30 minutes ago.
Yeah, we actually waited to start this podcast so he could finish Dragon Age. I was kidding.
But man, oh god.
So how was it?
It was worth it. It was worth the grind. The final battle was actually cinematic in a way that it's kind of, oh god, I don't know. I have to go to spoiler territory.
Here. Okay, I mean, still want to play the game, but I have no idea when that's going to happen. Maybe in like 5 years.
But where did you stop during your campaign?
I was like, far. Far from where you are now. I think.
Have you already met Morgan?
Nope, I have not yet met Morgan.
Okay.
I mean,
so you met Morgan at the second half of the game.
Okay.
And she explained something about the illusion. So it's something about a magic mirror that you can use to move. I mean, to go to other places.
Okay.
And that's something like a plot device for Corypheus to use in his nefarious plans. So something plots later on, you get to go to some ancient elven ruin.
Okay.
That houses the Well of Sorrows.
It sounds okay. Fake.
Yeah, it sounds fake. So, I'm not making it. So this Well of Sorrows is an ancient elven place that if you drink on the well, you get to absorb every history of the ancient elven culture.
I thought you were gonna say you're gonna get really sad.
The thing, I mean, they also, I think they also mentioned in the game that why is this called the Well of Sorrows?
Oh, really?
Yeah,
because like, why would you call it Well of Sorrows?
Yeah,
wouldn't you call it?
I think the original name is Verabelasan, something like that.
Oh, but that's just a translation, basically.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
The Well of Sorrows. So it's located within the Temple of Mithal. So Mithal is actually an important character in this game. Because she was the, like, if you're gonna drink on the Well of Sorrows, you're gonna drink Mithal. Or something like that. Like,
gonna
like
drink the essence Mithal. Of Mithal
is gonna go inside you. Because she's the goddess of, I don't know, whatever. And she has all the info you need that, you know, is related to the ancient elves. So there's this choice that it's either Morgan drinks from the well or you destroy the whole thing. Because Corypheus men are actually after the well for nefarious reasons. So you stop the guys, you stop the baddies, then you, well, I did. What I did was I decided to drink from the well.
You drank the well.
So, yeah, I drank from the well. Actually, I actually offered Solas to do it. Because he's the fanboy, right?
Uh-huh.
About ancient elves and shit.
Uh-huh.
But he fucking puts it out, man. What the fuck? I thought this was what you wanted.
Hey, this is your dream. This is like as good as it's gonna get.
Thousands of years of ancient elf.
You're about to get a hard on Mithal, like from drinking from this well. Like that is your dream.
But nope.
He's like nope.
And you gotta go back to that one. They have to go back to that one because it's important. But anyway,
okay.
You drank from the well, so you got a Mithal inside you. Then
yeah,
you
did.
Go to this temple of Mithal.
Yeah.
Another temple site so that you can actually get a new companion for your fight with Corypheus, which basically the dragon you see in the trailers.
Oh, okay.
So you get to have a dragon of your own, like Corypheus. So it's going to be a fair fight.
Mm.
So to get that dragon, you need to summon Mithal. So I summon Mithal, and guess who Mithal is?
Grey Warden.
Flemeth.
Oh, Flemeth?
Yeah. Like, When I was watching, I was like, son of a bitch!
You're like,
Mithal, you bitch! I was really...
I'm like, fuck yeah, bitch!
And even, it was funny, because even Morgan was having the same reaction as me.
Mother? Like, really?
Yeah, so like,
so, and then, so, like, everyone, like, walks away, except for Silas. He's like, ooh.
Yeah, so anyway, friend of the fierce, out of nowhere, everything's like, okay, what is happening?
Like, and what the
are,
fuck?
Are you mythol? But you're not even an elf. Like, Flemeth, like, explained that she's, like, a vessel of mythol from ages ago when she wasn't yet a known witch.
Right.
And she's been carrying mythol ever since. So that's the thing.
Carrying mythol? And then, like, as a child?
So she... Not as
oh,
a
no,
vessel,
like, okay, know. Okay, yeah, yeah.
Yeah. So she offers help to the Inquisitor,
uh-huh.
which is like, I don't know, should we trust your mother more again? And they're like, oh, you bitch.
And
anyway, the story still goes that Funnest will help you. And you get to fight another dragon, like the one you're gonna get.
Yeah.
So you have to tame it first. Once you defeated the dragon, the final level will appear on the map. So I got to go fight Corypheus, and it was, oh god, that was the most, I mean, oh god, that mission is worth it. I mean, that final battle is yeah. worth the grind that I put out on this game. Because it started out as Corypheus trying to levitate parts of your castle.
Uh-huh.
And then, that's your whole arena, so the battle starts with Corypheus, so it's just a 1v4 of you guys, and every time you guys hit him for X amount of damage, he goes to other places around that castle.
Okay.
So it's like you're chasing Corypheus
yeah.
in a cinematic way.
Okay.
It was awesome. I mean, imagine that happening while two of the dragons are fighting.
Oh, in the air. Back. Oh,
nice. Yeah. Oh,
God. Oh, that's like it's just like epic right awesome. There. It's almost just like let's build up a story so we have an excuse to have two amazing dragons like fighting each other in the background.
And yeah. it works. I mean, the music,
yeah,
even the accompanying music is epic. So after that battle, Corypheus dies, obviously, and the orb that Corypheus carries also. It was also destroyed.
Okay.
And Solas tried to recover it. He said that, no, it's still destroyed. So the Inquisitor says, I'm so sorry, but we need to do it to destroy Corypheus. And so you kind of see Solas kind of sad. And
sad.
Out of, I don't know why. But he was, sad. I mean, the whole gang was cheering.
Uh-huh.
Saying that, yeah, we beat the game, something like that.
Yeah.
But Solas was just beside one pillar, just like contemplating what he's done. Like, he was so much of an outsider. It was funny. And after that, the Inquisitor kind of looks for Solas, and he disappeared.
Oh.
And he was out of the game, which is what? Solas out of the game. So he was out of the party. Look. We're ready to go, so something like that.
I feel like they'll come back with like an expansion that touches on his story again.
Yeah, I think they did.
Yeah.
Yeah, anyway, the epilogue started, and it was like a ceremony or a party in your Skyhold.
Your Sky Castle?
Your Sky Castle. So you get to talk to your companions about what will happen to the future, blah, blah, blah. Then you go to your bedroom.
Oh, and
then you get to actually spend one more time
with Flemeth.
With your companion. If Flemeth's your companion,
not Flemeth.
Go ahead. I'm not going to judge you guys.
I can get some mythol in you.
Some mythol in your thigh or something.
Mythol in the sheets.
But yeah, after that, the credits roll and they explain what happened after a few years.
Okay.
Like, in my case, in my game, Cassandra, which is my, companion.
Yeah, my which one's Cassandra? Dubs, is she the tanky short hair girl?
Yeah.
Okay.
So she became the new divine for the Chantry
mm-hmm.
in my game. Then, what else happened? I guess that kind of put what's important to show in that after credit scene. But anyway, after the credits roll, they show this scene inside the Illuvian realm.
Yeah.
So they show Mythal as Plummeth.
Mm-hmm.
Speaking to someone called the Dreadwolf.
Okay.
And it appears that Dreadwolf was actually Solas.
What?
Yeah.
Okay.
And what happened was, he was saying that he made a mistake giving Corypheus the orb in the first place.
Mm-hmm.
So it was Solas all along who actually gave Corypheus the orb. And it's like they're explaining that Solas gave the Inquisitor the mark also.
What?
Yeah.
Okay.
So Solas is actually
a major character. Yeah.
And what happened during that exchange is that he said sorry to Plummeth, and Plummeth also said sorry, then they hugged. I don't know why. But after the hug, Plummeth kind of died out.
Okay.
And Mythal's essence transferred to Dreadwolf's.
Okay.
So the final scene shows Solas with Mythal's eyes. So it's like a blue sparkly eyes going on. So it's either Solas kind of sucks in Mythal.
Mm-hmm.
Or Mythal willingly gave Solas her essence. Something like that. So there's this thing going on. Like DLC bait or sequel bait happening. And that's it. That's the whole after credit scene. It's the cliffhanger scene. Just awesome. I mean there's there's a whole article about that if you really want to to get into it. On how Solas tricked everyone in the beginning of the game.
Mm.
And there's a lot of cutscenes or kind of audible clips.
Yeah.
That kind of threw off who Solas really is in the game. Like, you know, like those companion banter that you get.
Play. Like the, like the conversations you can have, like, well, back in Origins, like the ones in the camp and whatnot.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah.
So that's what happened. And after I play the game, I try to go to the wiki.
Oh, you look it up. Yeah.
See if there's a DLC about Solas, and I think they did release the final single player DLC for Inquisition last September.
Oh, they did.
So it's named Trespasser. So it's kind of like the end game the end game between the Inquisition and Solas, or something like that.
Okay.
So they explained how Solas who Solas is, and what's his game all along, and stuff like that, which I haven't fully read yet.
Mm.
But I don't know if I'm planning to buy DLC, this goddamn EA.
Wait, how much is it? It's kind of...
I don't know. I'm expecting 15 or 10 bucks for the DLC. But I'm not going to buy that shit.
Well, just Google how it ends.
Yeah, I'm just going to watch it.
I'm going to play it. I need to play Dragon Age Inquisition again, so maybe if I get there, and I like the story enough, then I may get the expansion.
After the game, you get a new game plus. So, not a new game plus, but once you finish the game, you're free to do whatever you want. Anyways.
Oh, okay. Still explore the same world afterwards.
But the thing is, once you finish the game, whoever became the divine, which is in case Cassandra for me, and Solas is out of the game.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, so
just don't use those guys.
You can't use those guys. But yeah, that's my weekend. Like, that's my whole weekend.
That's my entire year. It feels like it's years in the making.
Finally, I can play Resident Evil. And
the story is years in the making. Well, just a year in the making.
It is good. I mean, finally I can finish more games.
I can sleep better at night now, knowing that I finished these games. Yeah, I have way too many games in the graveyard. They're just collecting dust. Oh god! Like I remember. Like I buy a lot of my games during Steam sales, and like I still have like Tomb Raider. Like I still want to play that.
Oh god, you haven't.
I have not finished. Well, I played it, and then I haven't finished it.
Oh.
I stopped because we played something else, and then I just never got back to it. And then same story with Dragon Age. Same story with Shadows of Mordor.
Oh, Shadows of Mordor. Actually, this Christmas, I'm planning to finish Deus Ex.
Mm.
Because I haven't finished it since, 5 years ago?
Damn.
bought it. So that's a huge achievement.
Oh, man.
But whatever.
Oh, man. Let's see.
So what about you? I mean, you watched
for me. I didn't play any games. I was more just like watching stuff. So you know, just the usual, One Punch Man, like what we talked about. But this weekend I saw the mid-season finale for Gotham.
Oh,
okay.
Yeah.
So yeah, there's.
How was the show?
Well, the season finale for mid-season finale for Gotham. Wait, do you watch the show or?
No. I'm okay to be spoiled anyway.
You're okay to be spoiled?
I don't know if I can touch that show after, a lot of stuff came out.
Okay, so just a quick rundown. Like, towards the end, basically, it becomes, I mean, obviously, there's a villain that they're going after, but, like, I think the bigger story at the end of the mid-season finale is,
Barbara?
No, she had something to do with it, but more of like just Jim Gordon is now kind of, well, what people are saying is like going, like coming to the dark side, because now he's become almost like the Batman of his time.
Really?
Yeah, which I think is like,
okay,
it's kind of weird. Okay. It's kind of like, if I'm being perfectly honest, it's kind of weird because it's now the show kind of feels like
Batman.
They're doing Batman, but like in a different time.
Type of
Batman. Yeah, kind of. Because in the end, they also reveal Hugo Strange, and they also reveal Mr. Freeze. And in this iteration of Mr. Freeze, for some reason, he's like walking around with a freeze gun already, which is kind of odd to me. Because, well, for one, Victor Freeze wasn't always, like, you know, just some weird guy who was, like, walking around freezing people. Victor Freeze was someone who initially wanted to preserve his wife because his wife was sick.
See, I can't. This is why I can't kind of watch Gotham seriously.
Mm-hmm.
They really messed up with the timeline.
Yeah.
Like, I don't know, like, the Kid Joker and the explanation why there's a Kid Joker that Joker's every one of us waiting to be insane.
That's funny because like that actually now that sounds like that's the idea of the Batman. It's like it's not the person, it's the symbol. So now it's like, okay, so is the Joker the symbol now? So like anyone can be the Joker. It's basically what I'm hearing.
Yeah, I think that's what they're trying to like. They're planning to show.
Yeah,
in the series,
I feel like they're
with Barbara going. I don't know, kind of like Harley Quinn.
Yeah. Like, for a little while, she was kind of like Harley Quinnish, but
it's weird.
I mean, I'm still gonna watch the show. I think it's like it has some like good points to it. Like I still like how they're developing Bruce's character and like Alfred's character, like around like you know influencing him as he grows. Like, there was this really clever scene where Bruce manages to trick one of the main, I guess, the villain of the season.
Uh-huh.
And, like, she had, like, a little sidekick. Her name was Silver, and she was trying to manipulate Bruce. And then Bruce kind of caught on. And so he was trying to extract, like, information from her, but obviously she wouldn't give it. So Bruce did this, made, like, this really cool play where he and Selena kind of, well, using Selena's context, they basically get Bruce and Silver kidnapped, and then they were going to get tortured. And what happened was, it's actually, if you watch Sons of Anarchy, the guy who plays Chibs, the guy with the Scottish guy with the scar on his on his cheek, he's the guy who did the kidnapping. So I was like, I was kind of laughing as I was like seeing it going. I was like, oh Chibs, you've fallen so low. Oh Chibs, couldn't cut in the club.
But anyway, Chibs, you rascal.
So basically, you know, he was threatening Bruce and Silver, and then he pulls Bruce to like another room, saying that he's going to like torture him like even more. He's going to like beat him or like do things to him. And so Bruce, like in the other room, is just like screaming, and then like he stops all of a sudden. And so suddenly Chibs comes out of the room, and he's like wiping his hands with like supposedly blood, and then he starts threatening the girl. And then it was kind of like the girl is suddenly like, she has a change of character, like suddenly she's like super brave and she's like fierce. She's like, she starts threatening the guy who was threatening him and Bruce like earlier, and she goes like, you don't know who my uncle is. Like, he's...
So that's where he got the...
Yeah, that's how they got the information that, oh, yeah, she is working for this guy, Galavan. Which, by the way, Galavan, his history is apparently is...
family.
Yeah, his family is also... they also kind of touched on the... what was it? The Dumont?
The Dumont?
Yeah. Okay. So I was like, oh, okay. But no Azrael. For now. The Order of St. Dumas. But it was weird because like they had like these disciples or like worshippers of Dumont where they were like almost immune to physical injury. Well, not immune, but like they don't feel pain. Like they get stabbed and they still keep going. They'll still try to like, you know, kill you if they want to kill you.
You really should introduce the Court of Owls.
I feel like they should. I feel like they should. Yeah. Out of everyone they've introduced so far, I feel like they should do that. Like,
it's like the Court of Owls is kind of in. I mean, at home in this TV series, since this is all history.
That's true. No, that's absolutely true.
And they can capitalize it.
Yeah, I kind of like how they did the this one, the Order of Saint Dumas. Like, if they like that, having that here, it feels like it belongs. Even Court of Owls would belong here.
I think they're basically trying to do Court of Owls in the Dumont family art or something like that.
So
now they have talents for soldiers.
Yeah,
you know what I mean.
Well, they can't. Oh yeah, that's true, huh? Stuff. That's true. It sound disciples actually sound really pretty much just like talents. Yeah, but if you put it like in that setting, like Jim Gordon probably can't fucking handle a talent. Like,
good guy. Yeah, like, they, no way. He really can.
Yeah, yeah, like, no. Are you shitting me? But yeah, apart from.
So how do you feel about Gotham, you know, the overall mid season premiere?
The progress.
Yeah. How is Gotham doing? With that one.
I like it. I like it better than the first season for sure, but I still feel like they are burning through material so fast, and like they have character progression. Like, it's like you can tell, at least for the people that matter, they grow and they are developing closer to what their characters are in the future, which I like. I really appreciate it because it's like it's consistent.
Yeah.
But story-wise, they are burning through so much material. And I feel like the introduction of the introduction of Hugo Strange is more of like, okay, we're burning through so much of these materials now, we need to recycle some of them. Because, I feel like that's what's happening.
Yeah, I think what I'm going to get is, oh no, we're kind of running out of, you know, rogues. What do? We we show more of them.
Yeah, because it
unleash Mr. Freeze or something like
that. Oh man, it's terrible because like every time they put on Hugo Strange, it's like a reminder to me to like, oh yeah, we need to recycle these guys because they're bringing back basically villains who've already passed. So like they have what's her face, Jada's. No, Zaz is still out there. He's still like running around.
Okay,
I think he still works for Penguin.
Fish, I guess.
Oh yeah, Fish. I'm pretty sure she'll come back and like, well, just this more recent villain, Galavad.
Yeah,
he's probably gonna come back for sure. But yeah, and even Firefly.
Oh yeah. Yeah. Just got the rest of it.
But yeah. Yeah, I don't know. I'll still watch it. Like, I can still enjoy the show for what it is.
That's Batman.
Yeah.
He got back.
I do need, like, a Batman fix for, like, a TV show.
So, speaking of Batman, what about the crossover event?
Oh, yeah.
Like, I think that's the thing that I really miss this week.
Yeah.
Like, I haven't watched it yet.
Yeah, you really have to watch it, because I really liked it. Like, let's put it out.
Can we say it's better than the first crossover they did?
For sure. I think the story that, like, the way that they carry the story feels more organic to me. Like, I feel like you'll see it when you, like, obviously you'd see it when you watch it, but, like, the way, the previous crossover felt like when they were doing the whole crossover thing, everything happening in their lives was put on pause. Everything happening in their series, related. It's still kind of there, like it's still kind of happening in the back and you see a little of it, so I kind of appreciated that. I think there were two things that I had an issue with this crossover, but you know, I think I'm okay with that. I think as they are going through and like, you know, pushing the shows even further, they're getting better at it, because I feel like if I rewatched the first season of Arrow, I would feel like, oh my god, this is like the cheesiest TV show like in the world.
I can't watch the first few episodes of that show.
No, I can't. It's so... It is so cheesy.
They're going to go straight to the finale for that one to make it more interesting.
Like, they did better in, like, the Flash first season, but, like, the Arrow first season, I was like, this is cheesy as hell. Like, I hated it.
Yeah, it's like... I think they're just trying to test the waters during that time.
Yeah, which is good. I mean, I feel like they found their footing.
Yeah.
I still kind of feel weird about the whole Ray Palmer thing. I don't know. It feels kind of like, oh, okay.
So are you excited about Legends of Tomorrow, which will be out in January?
Not really, no.
Really?
Is it, like, you know how I feel about the Legends of Tomorrow thing. It feels like a dump for the characters that exist in the two TV show universe, and they can't reuse them for the moment. Because then they would be like
Avengers.
They've made a recycled Avengers for, you know, DC characters in the TV universe.
Who knows? We'll never know what. You know,
maybe. I mean, they're bringing back the same villain from this crossover. So this crossover, they have Vandal Savage as the main villain.
Oh, okay.
And so
Vandal Savage is the villain for Legends of Tomorrow.
Then. Yeah, yeah. So like he's
the main villain.
Yeah, he's going to be the main villain for this one too.
Okay.
I mean,
I guess I know what I'm going to expect now.
Unless I like misheard or something, but
so I'm gonna expect Hawk Girl and Hawk Guy.
Yeah, they should. I believe they're going to be there. I think
right on the money.
Yeah, because I don't think Hawk Girl gets her own show yet.
Yeah, I guess she's just part of the legend.
Yeah, I think she's gonna appear there.
Yeah,
but going back to the crossover event, I don't know if you want me to mention anything. Are you, like, hypersensitive to knowing certain things?
No, dude, just go and spoil
it. Just go? It's not really a spoil, but more of, like, okay. I just want to make sure that you don't want, like, any surprises. Or if you want surprises, that you should keep it. Okay, my first issue is Malcolm Merlyn. So when they introduced Vandal Savage, Vandal Savage appears because he wants to kill basically Hawkgirl and Hawkeye, because he wants to get their essence. That's how he's an immortal. So basically their life force is tethered to each other. So in every reincarnation, Vandal Savage, if he wants to keep his immortality, has to kill the two of them. Right? Yeah. So Barry feels like Vandal Savage isn't a metahuman, so he goes to Oliver Queen, who's dealt with more of the mystic arts.
He's familiar with that.
Yeah. So he goes to him for help, and then for some reason, you know how they have a new, like, arrow cave, like, or the quiver, according to Harley Quinn?
Yeah, yeah.
You should call it the quiver. You know how they have a new layer, and then for some reason, Malcolm Merlyn just appears, like, at the corner. There's just this one corner that's, like, really dark in the arrow cave, and he just appears out of that corner every time with, like, a squad of ninjas. And I'm like, how the fuck do you keep just appearing there? And it's funny. Like, I think the best part that I love...
I think I would laugh when I see that scene. It's like,
you're like, why? Like, why? How do you get there? Like, hello, Oliver. Yeah. Yeah, he does that, like, twice. And...
It's intentional?
Yeah.
I think that's intentional.
I guess so. But it's like, oh my god, it feels like, so silly. Like
Merlin's door. This spot is Merlin's door.
Merlin's
corner. You better have space for it. Yeah.
Like, no lights.
You better have space for it.
No lights. He always just, like, appears out of the shadows, too. It's like, hello, Oliver. It's just weird. I felt like Merlin's character in this... And this crossover felt like a convenience, like, in order to connect certain things and to move things a lot faster, his character was introduced to this story arc. That's how I feel about it.
A know-it-all or something?
Hmm? Sorry?
He's the know-it-all.
He's kind of like, he basically gives them a lot of the backstories that, you know, Flash and Arrow were missing. They don't know. Yeah, so, like, according to League legends, like, here is, you know, Vandal Savage, and this is his story, blah, 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 blah. So it kind of felt like, oh, he's like a prophet now? Cool.
Yeah. Oh, he's the Ra's al Ghul. But, yeah, it's kind of sad.
I mean, the second gripe that I have is the fight sequence in the end. Kind of felt...
Who's the director for that one? What fight sequence for on the Arrow episode or the Flash episode?
The Arrow one, because that's where it ends. That's where the crossover ends.
Okay.
I mean, it has to be like within the budget. So I am just like having trouble with like the fight sequence. I feel like
you remember the episode before the crossover. I think the one that. I think the episode about Diggle's brother.
Yeah.
That episode has the best cinematography or choreography that they did in the season because of that director.
Who? What was the fight? I can't remember.
I think it's they kind of have this technique that they're doing that whenever there's a fight, they kind of pan the camera.
Mm.
So they're showing that the fight's immediately happening. So there's no beginning or end of the fight. It's already in the middle that's happening.
Oh, okay.
So they're just showing you that the fight's already there.
Yeah.
And then something's happened. Then there's this cool trick that they use that, they're following this character. Then after that, there's a lot of foreground action going on, something like that. So it's pretty cool.
Mm.
It's one of my favorite episodes in this season.
Mm.
Or Arrow.
Yeah, I do feel like they're getting better with, like, obviously the fight scenes. It's like not as.
No, that's the problem. That's the only episode.
Oh, that's the only episode? The
director did. Yeah.
Yeah.
So the other ones have different directors. Mm. Which is, I think, it's a good thing for TV series to to like adopt or apply.
Yeah.
Like,
oh, to
like
experiment.
Each director, experiment, like each director has its own vision, and they have to stick with that, with their signature vision to make each episode kind of unique. It's something like what they did for Adventure Time. You notice it if you watch the film.
Wait, is it really? Like, is it like multiple directors work on Adventure Time?
Oh, well, some multiple writers.
Mm.
Like, you kind of get it when you when you see like one bizarre episode between story arcs, but just this is kind of iffy, like kind of weird.
Yeah,
like, how come there's an episode about kaleidoscopes and such things, and then you see that this is a different director, a different animation director, or something like that.
Mm. So it kind of reminds me of Lost 2.
Lost?
Like, Lost had multiple writers go into the story and kind of, like, chime in. Like, I remember someone told me about this, where they had, like, an overarching, like, okay, here is, you know, where we're starting, and this is where we want to end up. And so, like, every writer who comes in kind of can do whatever they want as long as it leads to that end game.
Yeah, something like that. So it's like, I'm sticking to the overall script, but they have their own vision.
Yeah, like they can, they have the episode. They kind of have their own, you know, a little bit of freedom. It's not just like, oh, you need to write it where this is going to happen. Like, that's it.
So basically, you can compare it to comics nowadays. Like, you have these creative teams.
Right.
Which you are kind of a fan of, and you want to follow their work.
Yeah.
It's kind of like that.
Like Jeff Johns.
And like, you know, David Aja and Matt Fraction.
Yeah, you have a couple good ones.
Ed Brubaker or something like that. So yeah, that idea, you can actually adopt it in TV. And it would be very interesting. Like, you have this very Jeff Johns-centric episode, or this very kind of like a Buffy episode. Then who directed it? It's, you know, this guy from Avengers. I forgot his name.
Yeah, I'm like terrible with names.
Joss Whedon, sorry. Yeah, like a Joss Whedon episode. You know, something like that.
Yeah, well, to sum everything up, Flash Arrow crossover event, I like it. It's good. It's better than the first one. I feel like they're stepping up their game, and like, yeah, I think you like it. There's also like a surprise twist in the end. So that I'm not gonna spoil, obviously.
One question though.
Yeah.
Like, one question before we have a break. Does Diggle have, I don't know, Diggleisms?
Diggleisms?
Like, what did he do before in the crossbow? Diggleisms? I'm sorry. Like, Diggles. Does he have Diggles?
Diggles?
On this episode, like, did he do any funny, witty stuff like he did in the first?
Oh, he has a few. He has a few.
Oh, that's good, because that's what I'm like, actually,
like, trust me, the dialogue on this crossover, really good, really good. Like, the comedic chime-ins are like perfect. Like, they're really spot on. Like, Cisco, like,
killing it. Oh my god. I guess the first crossover, when they introduced Flash on Arrow's universe, I was kind of laughing out of Diggle's reaction. So he Diggles out in that scene. Like,
oh, man. It was funny because, like, basically, when Flash comes into Star City, he saves Team Arrow. And, like, he basically brings every person to like a different location. Oh, well, no, to like a further location. And then he stops at Diggle, and then like Diggle takes off his helmet and just starts throwing up.
Okay,
dude. I hate that. Oh, Diggle.
Yeah, I'm gonna watch it tomorrow, I guess.
Yeah, it's pretty good. Pretty good.
So, anything else?
I think just one more quick thing. Have recently read the rest of, well, the rest of the first issues for Darkseid Wars. Basically, it's...
Oh, you mean the God
issues? Yeah, basically the God issues. So basically, you know how Darkseid Wars was basically like, oh, Darkseid fought the Anti-Monitor and like Darkseid died, and so you know, like there's like a shift in power or something like that, and Superman became like a god through being in the black sun, the black core of you know Apocalypse.
Yeah.
And then Lex Luthor became the new Darkseid ish kind of. They fed him like the Omega energy or something, which I'm like, okay, that's cool. And then Batman became the god of knowledge by gaining the Mobius chair.
Yeah, the Mobius chair.
That
I really like Shazam's god name though.
the god of gods. Oh my god. That's actually one of the newer ones that I read. So it's Shazam, Green Lantern, and I think that was
it. I think that's Superman. The Superman one, I read a preview, like, he was so, I don't know, bitchy.
Yeah, he was basically like,
he was feeling the after effects of steroids.
Yeah, pretty much.
I need my milkshake! Something like that.
But I actually like the Batman comic for Darkseid Wars, because he... like, he kind of abuses the Mobius chair, and he's, like, a total asshole to everyone, like especially Hal Jordan. Like, granted, even before the chair, Batman was kind of an asshole to Hal Jordan. The chair did not help that at all. And so Batman, in the comic book, is now using his newfound abilities to kind of, you know, learn more about the things that he couldn't as a mortal.
Yeah.
So at the end of it, he is actually using the chair now to find out, to learn more about the Joker, which I thought was like, okay, like that would actually be something that I would ask myself if I were in Batman's shoes.
Yeah, that's interesting.
Yeah. So that part, I'm a little bit more excited to, you know, for them to like dive into. I want to see where that goes. But I have issues with the Hal Jordan part and the Shazam part.
But that's the good part.
The God of Gods part?
No. The Green Lantern comic is actually kind of heartbreakingly good.
What? He gives up his power in order to kind of reset everything?
Yeah, I mean...
it feels like another flashpoint.
Kind of, but if you compare the other God comics, he was the least douchey.
That's true.
The bunch.
Yeah, he was like, okay, I'll give it up for everything to go back to normal. I was like, okay, cool. Oh, I don't know. Maybe I'm just not attached to Hal Jordan's character enough for me to empathize with his decision. But I'm like, okay, cool. So you basically gave me... Okay, here's my problem with it. The reason why Hal Jordan became the God of Light is because, what was it? The creatures from Apocalypse went into the Green Lantern battery core, and then they merged it with, a mother box? So they're saying that the energy source from that becomes, you know, that's how... it's basically, that's how it created an essence of the God of Light. And then, like, Hal Jordan became the vessel for it. Mm-hmm. And it's kind of weird, because, like, in the comic books, he's explaining, like, how, you know, basically kind of, like, what the rules are for now his newfound power. And it feels like, as I was, like, reading through it, so it's like, so basically what you're saying is, now that you're a god, there is no willpower. It's more just, like, what you want to do. It's kind of like just your choice. This is what you want, this is what happens. It's not just like... so basically he's saying, like, as a god now, I don't need willpower. I just need to want to do something.
Okay.
So I was like, I get it. Okay. But to me, it's like, okay, I mean, you're still going to want to do something in order for you to decide to do it, so...
Yeah, that's basically the idea.
But the way that they describe, well, at least that's how I read it. I was like, okay, you're kind of contradicting yourself, but whatever. And it's like, the way that they describe the power that's coming from, well, basically, a core of a mother box, they're basically saying that it's the same power source as like what Superman has now, because they're saying that the Mother Box is powered by, you know, the energy of Apocalypse. Not the Apocalypse, but like the world of Apocalypse. So it's the same thing that Superman has, but like merged with a Green Lantern battery. So like Hal Jordan can use it too, you know what I mean? So it's kind of like, okay, it kind of just sounds like you're making the story just so that everyone becomes a god.
Well, I think since that happened during Darkseid Wars, I mean, I think that's what they need to connect it to.
I guess so.
Order for the story to work, I guess.
I mean, it is what it is. He gave up his power. He's cool with it now. But the Shazam story, the God of Gods.
Yeah, this is one I haven't read.
Oh, you haven't read this one? Do you want me to spoil it?
The God of Gods.
Do
it.
Just mention it? Okay.
I think I'm going to laugh at him.
Okay. Here's a quick rundown of what happens. Basically, when Darkseid died, it kind of caused... The way that they explained it is basically Billy Batson's the gods that he was like currently getting powers from, so like the Might of Hercules and like all the gods who are like listed as Shazam's power, basically imagine it this way: Shazam's power kind of blinked for a second, and the second that it blinked, other gods filled in the spots. So like he has there's a new line of gods who's trying to take over Billy Batson's body now.
Okay.
And it's kind of like he has to regain their trust, kind of, or like be able to control them. Because basically there's a, like there's different gods. So like there's, I think one was like a goddess of seduction or something. And then it's funny because like Billy kind of, it was like in the middle of a lightning bolt, everything kind of happened really quickly, but obviously they show the whole thing in the comic books. Basically Billy visits all the new gods now, and he's like meeting them, and then every god kind of makes their case, like why you need me, because I can do this. And then Billy kind of for some reason is just being a total asshole, like to every god that he met, he's just like, I don't need you. Like, do you know who I am? I'm Shazam. Like,
the God of Gods.
Like, I'm the God of Gods. Like, I don't need you. Like, every god he treated that way. And for some reason, everyone, like, fell in line. But at the end, it was funny because one of the gods who got the spot is Darkseid's father.
Okay.
So
he
was fighting the wizard who gave Billy his abilities. And he almost lost, but like Billy suddenly just appears and like Shazams it and like just beats the living crap out of Darkseid's head. And so basically the wizard goes like, well, they have like a longer conversation about what's going on, and he basically says, oh, Billy, you're such an asshole. And then he basically he gives him Darkseid's father as part of his abilities.
Oh, okay.
So, like, his might is now Billy's might. So he is now as strong as Darkseid.
That's kind of scary.
Minus the Omega beams, so... So he's like really powerful right now. If like everything is true, and like I think he lost the ability to fly though. I don't think he can fly anymore.
I guess he can live without that.
But he's like super strong, and he has like this fire that doesn't get extinguished unless he wills to let it die. Yeah, so it's like a living fire or something. I was like, oh shit, okay, Billy.
So what? So he went really bad.
No,
in that comic,
I don't know.
So innocent, though, Billy.
Well, I feel like they grew his character in a little bit more arrogant fashion. Like he's basically at this point, he's not a kid anymore. He's a teen.
He's kind of depicted
that way. He's kind of like a teen, and so he's like a little bit teen more parents. Arrogant compared to, you know, what it was when he was a kid. He was just like, okay, oh, that's cool, I get to meet Superman, let's all be friends. Kind of. He's not that guy anymore, or at least they're moving him away from that, which I kind of like, to be honest. But yeah, I think I am kind of okay-ish with that. It was it's an interesting storyline, because I kind of get, like, okay, since a god died, like, his powers fluctuated. Like, okay, I can swing with that, you know what I mean? But, like, everyone else kind of just felt forced to me. Like, the Hal Jordan story, I didn't really, like, having issues with it.
What's your favorite Dark Side Wars one-shot comic?
Oh. Just by default, I would say Batman, because I'm curious, like, where it plays out, but I think I wouldn't count that, because that would just always be my number one. But I think, I guess top three would be Shazam would go number two, because it feels right. It feels like it could happen. And then number three would be the Black Flash, Black Racer.
Oh, yeah. It's awesome.
Like, God of Death, Flash, like, him, like, trying to embrace death now so he could control it, kind of. Yeah. So, out of all of them, obviously, bottom of the barrel so far, it's Hal Jordan at the very bottom, and then Superman and Lex Luthor at the very, like, next to that. Just can't. Nah.
I don't know. I mean, these stories are kind of okay, or, you know, good, but
yeah,
I don't know. Here's the thing with DC comics is, like, their Justice League timeline is kind of problematic.
It's always problematic, like, with their timeline.
I think it's set years after, or years before the current timeline of, you know,
oh, like what's happening, other individual DC comics. I feel like it's later on, because. Yeah, you're right, because I remember I was trying to catch up on the Superman comics, and...
Yeah, it's a different, arc now.
Yeah, I'm like, what,
like, he's empowered,
is
there
going on, huh?
He's depowered there, like, he isn't that strong.
He's not that strong, right? Yeah. That was, like, the whole thing about him, like, solar flaring, and now he's getting abused.
Yeah.
It's like, oh, you're my battery now. Keep charging my solar panels. Just keep solar flaring.
I
did not know about that superpower, by the way, the solar flare thing. Like, come on, go. Tension Hand did that. Like, come on.
No, it's not.
No, it's not. It's not blinding.
That kind of solar flare. It's actually damaging.
Yeah, that was my initial reaction. Like, Tension Hand.
Like, don't insult Tension Hand's weakness. I'm just saying.
Oh, it's funny, but yeah, it's like, okay, he burst out, like, but all the solar energy.
Speaking of Dragon Ball,
yeah,
would you believe that now that Superman kind of depowered this past events, if you think about it, he's not as strong as Goku anymore?
I don't think
rather,
he was, like...
But rather, he's now on the same level as Krillin.
What?
In my opinion.
You think so?
In my opinion. Well, yeah, I mean, Superman can't fly anymore. He can only jump.
Yeah,
like Jessica Jones.
Yeah.
And he also has, you know, he still has super strength, which is good.
Mm-hmm.
But, yeah, he's not that invincible anymore.
I think, originally, Superman was levels above Goku. I don't feel like they were even at all.
Yeah.
But with the recent
depowering,
I feel
like... you agree that he's just as strong as Krillin?
Maybe like Piccolo, but... Yeah,
no,
maybe.
I don't know. I mean, Piccolo can fly.
That's true. That's true.
Well, that's kind of, you know...
I mean, Superman still has his ability. Oh, yeah, then I guess we should, like, break that to, like, a different topic. Yeah, that might actually be next week's episode, because I feel like... We can really do it. Yeah. Well, hopefully.
I hope so. Yeah. He's a powerful being.
Let's save that one, because we need our anime expert on this one, too.
Yeah.
To fight for the Goku side. Well, the Krillin side. At least he's not going to go, just as long as he doesn't go Yamcha level, I'm good. I'm good with that.
If Superman goes Yamcha level, it's like you're saying that.
Well, Batman is basically Yamcha level.
No, I don't think so. Like, that's kind of an insult to Yamcha.
I mean, not at the current stage of Batman, because Batman's pretty powerful right now.
Yeah. I guess
it's an insult to Yamcha.
If you're gonna compare Yamcha to DC,
you know, Yamcha's never like beaten anyone that's like not human, right?
Yeah, I guess. I mean, Cyberman?
He
got trained by Cyberman.
Yeah.
Anyway, we'll take a break, and after this, we'll have our new feature topic. So stay tuned.
Yeah.
And we're back. So today, well, rather this week's feature topic, we're going to do something different. And we've been planning this since 2 weeks ago. It's a movie club topic. So it's just going to be us trying to rewatch or review or kind of have our, I know, 2 cents about a film that we're going to watch for the week. Like, a film that we agreed upon to watch it.
Yeah.
Mind you.
And, like, literally, so, like, really just dive down and, like, really break it down.
Yep. So this week, and for the first movie club episode for Jeffrey, we're going to feature Home Alone because it's the holiday month.
Holidays, like, season. Right around the corner. So what better movie is there to feature than Home Alone?
Yeah, so Home Alone, its stars Macaulay Culkin, Joe Pesci, Daniel Stern, of all people. And directed by Chris Columbus, not the Christopher Columbus, but Chris Columbus. Music by John Williams, can you believe that? Wow. Anyway, so, yeah. So I've watched this since I was, like, 5 or 6 years old.
Yeah, it's crazy.
It's one of my favorite films, actually,
mm-hmm.
during Christmas. And you know, there are some, I gotta admit, there are some parts of the film that I can't remember or can't understand as a kid. But when I rewatched it, I was okay. This is kind of a whole new movie.
Yeah, it makes sense now. Like, certain things make more sense.
Yeah, like, for example, we're gonna dive down now to our kind of story rundown. So, on the first few minutes, we see the McAllister's family trying to pack up their bags and, you know, trying to prepare for their Paris trip, right?
Yep, they're in, like, in a rush.
Yeah, they're like in a rush, and there's this cop who's in their house trying to find the father.
Yep.
So mind you, when I was little, I thought this was just a normal cop. And that's it.
I didn't think of anything of it like when I was like watching it at first.
So I was so surprised that when I kind of rewatched it yesterday, I was like, hey, this sounds and looks like that villain. He is the bad guy. So he's kind of casing the joint.
Yeah. And I thought it was actually pretty clever, because for the longest time, I thought that they had they just randomly pick houses that they just, you know, maybe they just, like, scope them out or something.
That was like what I thought when I was little. Like, this is just, like, it's just circumstantial thing that the McAllister's house is going to get, you know, house.
Just get mugged.
Yeah,
house gets robbed. They're like out on vacation. Their house is gonna get robbed.
Yeah, but now that we rewatched it, now that I see that, you know, he's actually casing the joint before doing the mugging. So it's just, wow, okay, this is kind of deep. And you know, the dialogue that the McAllister family is having about Kevin and all is kind of eye opening to me. That, whoa, that's kind of, I don't know, this family film thing's kind of heavy.
It actually, like, the way that I see it, it's like, it kind of opens your eyes to, like, oh, this kind of family, like, I guess, it feels like it's, you know, it's odd, because obviously, like, I mean, I guess you and I are going to be quite similar on this, but, like, obviously, Filipinos, like, the way that we're brought up is different. Like, if, you know, someone's being, like, bratty, then normally you get, like, scolded or you get spanked, right? Which is, for most Asian kids, going to be like that. But, for this movie, it's more just, like, they're, like, openly able to threaten each other. Like, you know, like, it's no big deal. And they just get, like, put, locked away in somewhere. And I feel like, you know, I guess
it's weird. It's a weird thing. This kid, like, the one with the glasses, is pretty fun. Like, whenever he was, like, he's not even a McAllister, like, he's kind of their neighbor or something, or just a cousin.
Wait, the one, gets, the kid next door?
No, the kid with the small glasses, I forgot.
The small rounded glasses?
Yeah, who got squished by the uncle.
Yeah, when the chair gets pushed back.
It's very funny. If he was like, I mean, you can see, you know, how family values were working on during that movie.
Yeah.
And, you know, that moment when Kevin actually wished for his family to disappear right in front of his mom was kind of, wow, okay.
I was like, whoa.
You're just kind of heavy, Kevin.
You're a kid.
You don't know what you're wishing for.
You don't know
for.
What you're saying, but like, yeah. I feel like, how do you feel, before we like really like break everything apart, how do you feel about it like overall, seeing it then and now? Like, how do you feel?
I think I appreciate it more. Like, right. After I watched it yesterday, I saw a movie that has a lot of characters with a lot of flaws in them, as compared to when I saw it as a kid. Mm-hmm. It was just all about Kevin being home alone and his wacky
and like the traps
plan
and all the
defenders.
Yeah,
that's the thing that I actually just focused on when I was a kid. Mm-hmm. This time, I kind of appreciate what the other characters are going. I mean,
like what they do, what they contribute,
what are their problems, especially the who's that dude, that big old guy that they're afraid of?
Oh, the neighbor guy.
Yeah, that church scene where they talk between what they fear.
Yeah,
that's pretty heavy.
Yeah,
like, wow,
this one like really
And it's kind of funny because Kevin made a very good piece of advice for him when it comes to, you know, fear and, you know, how to handle his son who hates him for years. So yeah, it's kind of
it's really a lot of give and take. I think for me, like, kind of like what you said, it's like growing up, well, seeing this movie as a kid, you kind of just see the funny parts where it's like a guy, you know, getting electrocuted or like slipping and falling or like gets his head banged up. But, like seeing it now, you kind of pick up on a lot of things and like all the detail and like all the setup. Like, to me, it's like an excellent movie in that sense because, you know, movies nowadays, they're like a 2-hour movie, but it's like, it doesn't feel like it's set up for anything. Like, you just see the action go like boom, 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 and like you're there. But for this, like, you can like really see, like, from the very second the movie starts, it's set up. Everything's being set up. Like, you're introduced very quickly to a huge number of characters, and it's like, you see how they move along in the story.
Yeah. And there's this moments also in the movie that you kind of see Kevin trying to grow up as a kid.
Mm-hmm.
That, you know, that has responsibilities.
Right.
Because like early on, like, he's being ridiculed, you know, that he doesn't know how to do shit.
Yeah, he's like childish. He's like a nuisance. Yeah.
But when he was home alone and he got the opportunity to actually do a lot of stuff that he needs to do in the house, like, you know, washing plates, you know, trying to get groceries.
Yeah.
Stuff like that.
Yep.
It's pretty funny. And also that, you know, that basement scene with the laundry thing is pretty.
Oh, yeah, yeah. The whole, the furnace thing where he, like, he imagines it's a monster.
When I was a kid, I didn't actually hear anything audible. And when the boiler started talking, but now I just heard it. He says, "Cabin." It was like, what the? Okay, that's pretty funny. One thing, though, I mean, one of my favorite things in this movie is the scene where he actually watches this film called City of Filthy Angels. It's actually, this is a fun fact, this is actually a parody film that's created for Home Alone.
Which is
which is based on a gangster film called Angels with Dirty Faces.
So, wait, really?
Yeah.
For the longest time, I swear, I thought it was like Scarface or something.
Yeah, me too. I actually was planning to actually get a copy of that film.
Just to see it?
Just to see it. But it's just made for Home Alone, actually. But yeah, that's one of the best things in the movie. It's like, especially the pizza boy, when he actually ordered a cheese pizza for, you know, when he was Home Alone.
Yeah.
And the pizza guy, the pizza guy went up and, you know, he said that this is like, what, $5 or $12?
Yeah.
And the way Kevin interacts with the pizza man is him trying to play the movie every time that, you know, every time the pizza guy talks.
Yeah, to emulate a dialogue with an adult.
Yeah, with an adult. So it's like, keep the change, you feel the animal. It's pretty funny.
Yeah, that was really clever.
Yeah, and he did that again when the wet bandits try to break and enter the house, and that is this time he improvised a little bit more to make it more real, and he uses firecrackers to make like the gunshots pop a bit more. So it's pretty funny.
Yeah, it gets pretty creative. Movie is just
good.
And like a lot of things that I don't pick up on. So like as a kid, like what you said earlier, the furnace scene, like I didn't understand like what that was growing up. Yeah, and then I saw it now and it's like, oh, it's his imagination. It's like him scaring himself.
Yeah, I think I kind of remembered something again. Like there's this scene during when he was buying a toothbrush and he saw that old guy again, right? Old man Marley, that's his name. So I just saw the Wikipedia. So he's an old man Marley behind him. So he was as any child, he was kind of scared.
Yeah.
And he ran off with a toothpaste that he hadn't bought. So he kind of shoplifted at that scene. So what the shopkeeper did was it's funny, he called this busboy, or is it
an attendant,
or the attendant in the shop named Jimmy. Jimmy chased him, and the way that the camera pans to him, to this Jimmy guy, and the way that the Jimmy guy acted upon is like a superhero. It's like he turned his face to the right side of the scene, and he swoops in, like exit stage left, something like that. And it's funny. It's like, wow, okay, that's super cheesy. Way to go. I mean, I think that's the only, like, the only two scenes that he has.
On like, he really pulled it out.
But he made it so cartoonishly.
No, it fits. So it fits the genre perfectly.
So, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I guess so.
Oh, man.
And I think the way that, you know, the wet bandits were tortured during their freaking entering scene. Says, "Oh man!" Like during when I was a kid, it's like, "Yeah, you guys got what you deserve," something like that. But now that I was watching it, and I was kind of like, "This like torture porn now. Why are you getting so like the like when Harry broke out of the broke inside the window and he kind of step on those
Christmas balls? The crushed Christmas ornaments. Yeah, because you hear like the crunching sound and it's like,
like
you put yourself in.
I don't know why, but it's too much.
No, I know what you mean. There's like certain scenes that are like, oh shit, it's like really bad.
Yeah, and also the
eye into the face.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh god, that's.
It's got
awful, painful.
Yeah. But it was like it's really entertaining, especially like even just random stuff that happens there. So like I remember like because you mentioned the grocery scene. He's like walking back. He's like carrying two bags of grocery. I think he wanted to like decorate the house with like Christmas stuff because he was gonna be in Christmas like all alone. So he was like decorating. So he bought Christmas stuff. And so, like, as he was, like, walking back, he, the two bags that he's carrying just rips. And he just gets, like,
I know the feeling. I know the feeling, Kevin. I think that happened to me, like, twice.
Yeah. But, yeah, like, seeing it now, I think it's weird, because, like, there are certain movies out there that I watch it, and, I mean, I watched it growing up, and then I watch it again now, and it's, like, the magic's gone. Like, you're not entertained by it at all. Like, you think it's, like, really stupid and childish. But I think for Home Alone, I feel like it's a movie that I can keep watching over and over again because of, like, the way that it's made.
Yeah, I mean, there's this timeless effect on you when you watch it.
Yeah.
Well, aside of the pros of the movie, can you, you know, can you spot anything that you didn't actually like about
the con? I mean, the con for me is more. It's not necessarily a con. I think it's more of just like
inconsistency.
Not so much. It's more just like okay, like everyone obviously plays their characters a little bit over the top, but it. You know, it's the genre.
Mm-hmm,
like, you need to make it, like, really funny and very expressive because you're catering to, you know, it's supposed to be a family movie.
Kids.
Like, for me, for my taste now as an adult, like, I'd rather it not be, like, exaggerated like that. Especially, like, the whole Kevin screaming part and, like, running around and, like, all that twirling and jumping stuff. Yeah. I feel like it's still too much, but I can see how kids would like really like it and start emulating, like just, you know, start copying it. And I'm probably like one of them growing up when I saw this movie. I was like doing the same thing probably, I'm sure. Mm-hmm. But in terms of like other cons, I don't think I really have any. Surprising. It's kind of surprising. Because normally I do.
I don't know. For me, I think it's.
Did you feel like there were any like inconsistencies? Because now that you mention it, like
probably the way that the Wet Bandits think during
times. Oh, where it seems like a little questionable. Yeah, especially in the early. Like you wouldn't do that, you know, in that order, kind of.
Yeah, like I don't know. Like I think it's about. The you know the angels with the angels apart because you know if you're a great you know you're a normal dude and you hear this shit is happening and you hear the gunfire but you
don't see bullet holes and you won't necessarily well I guess you'd see fire and I feel like you'd know the difference between firecrackers and gunshots.
Yeah,
it's way more distinct.
That's one thing. So, you know, you kind of, you gotta, you know, think of something fishy, like,
yeah,
what's happened? are we getting pranked? But I guess if it's,
I mean, it's, I know, it's a kid's movie.
It's the problem of the character itself. Yeah. And, yeah. You know, to make it believable.
You kind of just leave it to your imagination. Yeah.
But overall, that's the only gripe about
it. I feel like that kind of just comes with the genre, definitely, though. Yeah. Mm-hmm. But yeah, no. Yeah.
Also, I guess a con will appear when we touch on the sequel.
Yeah, because I mean, it always happens. Yes,
in the sequel, I think for me, for the sequel, well, we're not going to
get into full on detail. We'll just do a quick follow up.
Yeah, but the sequel, I think the only thing I don't like about the sequel is Rosie O'Donnell.
Rosie O'Donnell. I feel like I need to rewatch it again.
Yeah, she's the pigeon.
She replaces the man
in the sequel. Yeah, so her character is not that probably, but her character has some quirks.
She tries to add a little bit of feels to it. But anyway.
Yeah, kind of.
I didn't feel very much.
But yeah, Home Alone. I'm gonna give this 4.5 Kevins out of 5 Filthy Angels.
What? Four Kevins out of 5 Filthy Angels?
4.5 Kevins out of 5
Filthy Angels. I'm gonna give this one a 5. A full-on five. Because of all the reasons earlier, just character development, story, just to build up to the story, I think it's really well made and really well thought out. Everything's well written, the dialogue. Plus, nostalgia for nostalgic's sake, a little.
But is it 5 Filthy Souls or 5?
Might be Filthy Souls.
Out of 5.
5 Filthy Souls.
Out of 5 Death Bandits. There you go. So yeah, that's our feature. So probably next week.
Next week, do you want to go a little bit more modern, or do you want to go, something still back from the childhood? From our childhood?
Let's go modern. Let's go in it. Let's go deeper in the rabbit hole. I'm talking about the Matrix.
Okay.
I don't know. I mean, right now we have, we can watch The Matrix, we can watch Interstellar, we can watch the Superman movie.
Which Superman movie? That's
pretty interesting. I'm looking at our list here. The Christopher Reeve Superman movies. So it's Superman 1, 2, and I don't know if you want.
Okay, how about this?
But you mean the Brandon Rose one? So 2 Superman movies next week. Okay. Got it. Let's do it. And probably, I don't know, that one's in Saturday, December 12, 13, right? So, probably at 19 or 20...
We just have to.
We're going to do Star Wars.
Yeah, we definitely have to.
So that's expect at around 19 or 20, we're going to have a movie club about the Force Awakens.
Well, we might just do an entire episode that's just Star Wars.
Yeah.
Maybe. But I guess I end up doing that.
I guess that will happen. Because, I don't know, I mean, I really wanted to do a movie club about Elf. I don't know why, but it, in case you don't know, it's just X days before.
Wait, Elf, as in, is that the one with Will Ferrell? Yeah.
Will Ferrell? It's an Elf.
Okay.
That's a really good movie. But I don't know. Maybe we'll just do it in
the next season. Somehow, somewhere. Yeah.
Anyway, we'll try to go to news. So lots of news happened, especially right now,
like fairly recently,
or rather yesterday, during the PlayStation Experience 2015. So we have a lot of footage. You know, we have a lot of trailers that got shown on PSX2015, including new gameplay footage of the Final Fantasy VII remake, and as well as a new trailer announcement for Ni no Kuni 2, which is actually a good RPG for the PS3. Also, we have, you know, a new character introduced in Street Fighter V, which is Fang, who happens to be Shadow Liu's second in command. He is
Shadow Liu. Like
Shadow Liu. Oh god. Charlie-ism. I mean, Nash. Charlie Nash-isms. But yeah, he's Nash. So he's sort of like a Kung Fu Snake kind of guy, which he has this feature that Street Fighter 5 introduced, which is poison status.
Poison status. So he's
the first character to actually do poison status. But if you get hit by a poison affected move that he makes, you're gonna get damage over time.
Yeah.
Until the status wears out, or if he hits you again. Something like that. It's kind of a sleek, tricky character to use. But anyway, back to Final Fantasy VII, which is more important. We get to see kind of an idea on what
there's a little bit of gameplay footage. How do you feel about that?
Yeah.
The whole, I know the internet right now is a little bit reacting to it. It's like, it's not.
Oh
it's
god, not the internet. The internet is dumb that? Right now. You know what? This is funny because
Final Fantasy VII it's isn't like even everyone turn-based. It's everyone gets their own timer.
It's an ATV and like system
they get to move.
Yeah, so everyone complaining about this not being turn based.
Like you don't know
what dude, Final you're not playing Final Fantasy VII. You don't have any idea what it is. Yeah. Or probably you know about ATB, but it's set to wait. So you're kind of playing like
turn-based for Final Fantasy VII. You make it turn-based.
Yeah, which isn't the right way or the correct way. But
that's not the way that they teach it.
Yeah, and you know, there's a lot of people also saying that, no, this is Kingdom Hearts gameplay. No,
it isn't. Oh my god, no. Oh, I think what it is like they're reacting to like when he does his slashes and whatnot. Like, do you see those like little sparks like flying and stuff?
I think Kingdom Hearts is an unfair comparison. You know what I think about when I saw the fighting, I mean the battles and, you know, overall gameplay? Yeah. It's similar to Crisis Core. It should be.
Oh, yeah. I see what you mean.
It's like the Crisis Core sequel that we need to actually get, and it's in the form of Final Fantasy VII, and that's good. I mean, it's funny because
because to me, when I saw the gameplay, it kind of reminded me of Dissidia for some reason.
Oh yeah, that one also.
Because of like you know just the movement. I mean, obviously you don't have like the aerial battles kind of thing. You didn't quite have that, but I feel like movement wise, it kind of felt that way. But
you gotta be, you know, I mean you gotta wonder though, like how are they gonna do it on a 3
or like what party. The battle system is.
Yeah.
I mean, is it like one of those games where you switch around between the character and everything kind of happens at the same time?
Yeah, I guess so.
Which I'm okay with. Yeah. I actually like that.
Which is, you know,
because then it's like, you know, you watch a battle as it's like, you know, the battle is happening.
Yeah, and I kind of think. I mean, I kind of wonder if they're going to go real time with all the actions they're going to do.
That's like the whole like
ATB
twisting scene.
Yeah,
the twisting screen scene. Whenever like you detect an enemy, like it does that swirling
effect. Just a lot.
Yeah.
But you know, probably they're. I don't know. For me, probably they could include it, and I'm okay with it because it's. It kind of adds that nostalgia effect, but I don't know. Probably if they're gonna do it, they need to kind of tinker down the encounter rate, or probably do something modern. Like instead of random battles, they can still place enemies in the map, but whenever you touch them, it goes.
Yeah.
So bells starts.
Wait. So isn't that kind of like?
Kind of like.
FF8? Is FF8 like that,
or was it? It's like nine. It's like Grandia, or.
Oh, that's
right. I don't know. I think.
I feel like, yeah, a game has done that before. Where it's like, if you bump into someone, or like you're within a certain range of them, they'll run to you.
Yeah, actually, FF12 kind of has
it. Okay.
Although FF12 is similar to online kind of gameplay, which is so
cool. Mm-hmm.
But yeah, I mean, so far, from what they shown in the. In the trailer, it's kind of impressive. Like, I know a lot of people are now excited for Final Fantasy VII than Final Fantasy XV, which is ridiculous. Anyway, yeah, that's PSX 2015. If you want more detailed stuff that's happened in this event, you can always check on Too Much Gaming. Probably they're gonna upload their new episode this Monday or Tuesday. So they're definitely gonna cover PlayStation Experience as well as the Game Awards, which happened like Friday. I think it's Friday.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway. So speaking of Game Awards, I think you need to announce this one. It's.
Okay. Oh, wait.
Telltale.
Game Awards?
Telltale Games.
Oh, Telltale Games. Oh, yeah. I'm like, oh, wait, there's an award? Okay. Announced a new Batman game coming out.
Oh, yeah.
During the 2015 Game Awards.
Yeah. And they only showed a trailer, right? Nothing gameplay related.
It's not really a it's not really a trailer. I feel like it's more like a teaser. So it's like literally, you know, just like ink, like filling in like a certain art, like an art piece or something, and then you kind of see like the bat symbol kind of appear.
Yeah.
So it's really just more like a teaser that they're gonna do something like in the Batman universe, which I'm really, 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 really looking forward to.
Yeah. And I know. Right now, Telltale's Kevin Bruner said, according to Polygon, that this iteration of Batman will give fans a first-hand opportunity to dive deeper into the complex life and mind of Bruce Wayne. Okay.
So it's more
Bruce Wayne? I don't know. I mean,
more Bruce Wayne?
For me, what I want out of this Batman game is more detective stuff.
Oh, gotcha, like the being a detective.
Yeah, because,
and like,
I think Telltale's format is kind of at home in that kind of storytelling, like detective stuff, like when you see in the Wolf Among Us, that's pretty good Telltale game. And you know, something complex, like the ones you normally see in the Sherlock Holmes games, especially the latest one.
I just hope it's not one of those games where it's like, oh, just click, you need to find X, Y, and Z on this screen right now. And it's like, you click on random places because you can't find it.
Yeah, I was hoping to...
I just hope it's like not that kind of game.
I was hoping that there's the scene that, you know, Batman will piece something together. Like a riddle or a puzzle. Or like, who killed this man? And you need to, you know, you need to... search and look for evidence, then you need to piece this evidence and stuff.
It's kind of like that.
Yeah, something like that. Actually, those Arkham games actually have a good, you know, well, some moments have good detective gameplay.
Yeah, like
they've kind of sequence, sort of.
They should have more about those. You
know, you like those?
Well, it's kind of. Iffy most of the time, but you know.
Mm-hmm. I felt like it was kind of tacked on. Like it's nice that it's there, but it doesn't feel like it. You know, it was a major part of the main story. It was just like there, you can do this.
Yeah, it's like a side thing for you to handle.
Yeah,
but you know, if you can imagine that that this is the main thing that you're going to do in a Batman game. That would be wow. This Detective Comics.
I feel like that would not be for everyone, though.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah.
Yeah, Batman game come from Telltale. Also from Telltale, they announced that, what's this? The Walking Dead Michonne will premiere this February 2016.
Wait, so is that one a game as well? Yep,
it's a 3-episode miniseries by Telltale Games. So it is about Michonne during her early years before going in with Rick's group. So it's kind of interesting. It's just a half season. As per Telltale game standards, so it's just 3 episodes long. So it's kind of interesting. The trailer shows a lot of stuff that you normally see in, you know, the Walking Dead games from Telltale. A lot of gruesome surprises and twists there. And there's new survivors that are introduced in this game.
So, right.
And we see Michonne as kind of having shorter hair, shorter dreads.
Okay, so, is this going to be set in, like, the TV universe, or the,
Yeah, that's the thing, we don't know yet. Probably the comic, if it's safe. I mean, the safe assumption is it's going to be, you know, based on the comic book.
Oh, comic
books. But we won't know. I mean, in the first season of Walking Dead in Telltale, they featured Glenn, and it's voiced by that guy. From The Walking Dead.
Stephen Yeun?
By Stephen Yeun.
Stephen Yeun, yeah.
Maybe. Anyway, what else? Samurai Jack returns in 2016 on Adult Swim. This is a surprise. It's a surprise announcement. I really didn't expect that. Like, Samurai Jack. That's pretty cool.
I've always just kind of, like, wondered what happened to, like, all the other shows. You know what I mean? Like, during the time that Samurai Jack was out, there was, like, a couple of shows that were...
Yeah, like...
I felt like were really, like, hitting the stride. Or, like, they were, like, really good.
Yeah. And this is kind of a different direction, different take? Are you going to reboot the series?
I think it's progression. So it's still Jack, but like now, like we only get to see like a silhouette of him right now. But it seems like he's wearing like a shogun armor it's now. Kind of
different, and that's
right. Yeah. But you know, I think it's cool.
I wonder what they're gonna.
I'm excited for it
now that they're on Adult Swim, though. That's the question.
That's true. I mean. I feel like Samurai Jack was always a cartoon that kind of belonged in Adult Swim.
Yeah, I mean, he has a blade.
It's like him stabbing and like cutting stuff.
Yeah.
And it's like, yeah. I mean, of course, like it's a cartoon, so they wouldn't show, you know, like blood splatter or anything like that. Yeah, like it's styled in a way that it's just shadow. He's basically cutting shadow. Yeah. But, like, of course, if you, like, set it in, like, a more adult fashion, like, maybe it's a little bit more violent or something. Maybe.
I'm going to wait for Blood's Grace for this one.
Yeah. Let's see.
Anyway, more news. Luke Cage set photos revealed. Guess who's coming back from Jessica Jones? Any guesses?
I've actually not seen this one.
I haven't seen this one? Okay, I'll send you the link. But first, give me a good guess on who's going to return to Jessica Jones.
Kilgrave?
Nope, I'm sorry.
Oh, wait. Simpson?
Oh, God, no.
I mean, you kind of already know Simpson.
It's going to be Claire Temple. It's gonna be Rosario Dawson again as Night Nurse. So I think.
Wait, what?
Yeah, so I think Rosario Dawson's character is gonna be like the Coulson of this Netflix universe of Marvel. That
Claire Temple.
Yeah, the nurse, man, the nurse.
Oh.
So
I mean. I kind of expected her to, like, return anyway.
Yeah, surprise.
Damn it.
So yeah, set photos reveals Luke Cage and Claire Temple and street goods looking like normal people. What do you expect? But yeah, we also see some new characters, like this detective, this New York cop that has, I know.
Oh my god, is it another Simpson?
It's another Simpson. I don't know, but probably spoiler alert, he's gonna die.
He looks like he's about to die.
God. So far, I'm kind of actually surprised that they're already shooting for Luke Cage. That's pretty...
I feel like they gotta recover after Jessica Jones.
Yeah. That's a good thing that they're shooting it. And hopefully they're gonna release it earlier than November next year.
Yeah.
Yeah, hopefully.
Well, I think, aren't they also...
if they're gonna release...
Isn't there another one?
If they're gonna release the second season Daredevil in November, so probably we can expect Luke Cage mid-year. Probably in June or July.
Hopefully, because that's a good way to keep the Flames fan, just to keep it going,
hopefully we'll have more news this month, or probably next month.
Things are gonna start slowing down, I think,
for
at least a little while. Yeah. But, in other news, this is more like internal news and from where I work at. So basically what happened is very recently, our company, our client is, Lenovo, and they're trying to, kind of set the stage for them to jump into the gaming scene. Oh. Like they want to be a recognized brand, in terms of gaming now. So what they did was they partnered up with, Dark Rift and a few influencers, so Felicia Day, Machinima, Geeks and Sundries, and Funhouse.
Ooh.
So basically what they're going to do is it's a imagine
Wait, so,
a
so did Felicia sorry, Day sorry. Went to your office, or some of the guys from Geek and Sundry went to your office and after that?
No. Well, for Felicia Day, I think they went over to her to shoot some footages, but a few weeks ago we had Dark Rift and Funhouse. We had the guys meet in our conference room, so they just it was just everyone meeting each other for the first time.
That's awesome.
Their reaction, and it's them talking about the game, more about where the program's gonna be heading.
Yeah.
And basically, what the program is, it's a crowdsourced game. So basically the game is, the game is going to be, obviously they're going to program the game, but everything that goes in the game is, what they're looking. Yeah, it's going to be crowdsourced. So what the characters look like, what the monsters will look like, what the weapons and artilleries look like.
The community.
Yeah, it's going to be, it's a game. It's going to be made by the community. We don't have much detail yet on the type of game that it's going to be, but the program has just recently launched, and we actually have a team going flying over to the UK this week to kind of promote it. They have there's an expo going on right now in the UK, and I've heard that our team actually has a booth there to promote the program.
So wait, there's no news what genre are they going to tackle on? If it's going to be an RPG or an action game?
No, they haven't released it yet, no.
Interesting.
There's still a little bit of a mystery, I think. Or actually, I don't know if they released any new...
Because these are the same guys who made, I believe...
They're the same guys who made.
I mean,
God, what was that game? Torchlight.
They did Torchlight. They're the same guys who made Torchlight, right? So,
They're the guys who basically they came from Blizzard, and then
it's good.
Started their own thing. That's how Torchlight kind of came about, and that's why you know it kind of looks like, it looks very similar to Diablo, the Diablo playstyle.
Well, I guess if it's any opinion about this one is that if they have a good community to start with, and you know, that's a good thing for them to have a good community to start with, because if they're gonna rely on, you know, crowdsourced assets and ideas and resources, so they must have.
You need to have like a good pull.
Yeah. People a very solid, to, like, hear about it, a like, very solid voice, and you know, hopefully they won't get, you know, I mean, hopefully they won't get mashed or anything, like, you know.
Yeah, that was kind of the idea of why we wanted to bring the influencers in. So like, this is where Felicia, like Geeks and Sundries, and like Funhouse, and Machinima.
Yeah, that's
in.
Actually a good move. Like,
yeah, they have like a good following, and in a way, I don't know if this has changed, but the initial idea was that the influencers will be kind of like the, like, it's sort of like the moderators, or like they help guide the process, basically. Yeah. So it's not just like, oh yeah, like I'm on this website and I saw this, so I'm gonna start doing this too. So it's more just like, okay, basically the influencers are kind of there to like remind people like, okay, this is what we're doing now.
Kind of limit some stuff.
Yeah, just to keep everything a little bit in order. Yeah, and plus like, you know, keep it entertaining.
Yeah, I guess it would work. I mean, and, so far...
I mean, it's been done before. Like, this concept's been done before. Like, you have PewDiePie actually did something like this. I think it was like the Bro Army or something like that. Yeah. He launched a game a few weeks
ago. But it's PewDiePie. I mean, he has some fan base, and I know.
Yeah.
If Nova has
you
some,
can't really take him seriously.
And if, you know, I mean, it's about the fan interaction. So if you're gonna compare it to Lenovo or I know the guys who made Torchlight, so their fans need
I feel like it's grander.
Yeah,
I feel like it's a grander stage, and it's like a really good move because not to toot my own horn, but like because you want to be established in the gaming community, you have to, you know, give out, like, really, like, put yourself out there and, like, show people that, hey, like, we want to get into gaming, we want to understand your world, like, here's our first step in doing it. I feel like this is, like, a really good first step in doing that. It almost feels like it's kind of jump-starting their presence in the gaming community.
So
before I wrap that one up, I just wanted to give a quick shout out to our team, who's, well, they're not all going to be there. Some of them I'm going to see on Monday, well, tomorrow rather, but there's a few of them who are like going over there. But I just wanted to give a quick shout out to the whole Games Day team. So it's we got Marcus and Nathan. You're living the dream for me. Tim, Steven, and Kelly Joe. Yeah, Mike Rose, and Sharon and Laurelin.
Awesome.
So pretty much right now. Well, I mean, there's more people who are, you know, involved with the process. Oh, and Ryan too. Sorry. it's a big team, and I feel like, you know, it feels like they're pretty much the core of the program right now. Rick. So,
awesome.
Job to you guys. Hope you guys really push this thing to like its fullest potential, and I'm sure you guys are very capable of doing it. And looking forward to where it goes, for sure. Like, I'm still following it. Like, I check the website once in a while.
So any more, I mean, did they have any contributions so far from fans or from anyone?
Actually, I have the website open. I'll send you a link really quick.
Yes.
And you can actually, if you scroll up and around, like, you can see, like, other people have already started posting their own artwork for, like, character art. So definitely the ball has started rolling.
And anyone can actually participate in this game state.
Yeah, anyone can participate. I think the only difference is that sweepstakes are only available for, you know, just
Americans?
Like certain areas or like certain countries. Yeah. But for the most part, like anyone and like everyone is very much welcome to participate and like,
yeah, that's cool.
You know, just explore the website.
They have new submissions now. That's cool.
Yeah. So basically, the way the website works is like it's kind of like a mini game. So if you scroll down a little, you'll actually see like a leaderboard, and that's like people who are like active on the website. So they gamified the website as well. So like the more you explore, you actually unlock achievements on the webs on this website.
Oh, okay, that's pretty neat.
Yeah.
And so
like, you know, when you're logged in on your profile, you also kind of personalize your experience. So what that means is, let's say you're in we're already in like the fifth month or something, or, you know, it's like further down the line and we're already on like mission 5 or something. Your profile tracks the last mission you've seen, and you're able to like catch up based on when's the last time you logged in.
Mm-hmm.
So the top of the feed of your website is going to be whatever the most recent thing is that you haven't seen.
Yeah. Okay. That's cool. Yeah, so anyway, if you are a budding artist, or how can you say it? Like, if you want to go and contribute to this game project, you can do so at, you know, www.finovu.com/gamestate.
And like, even if you're not an artist, you know, if you're just like an avid gamer and you just want to like, you know, contribute, like you are very much more than welcome to like come in, like, exactly. Like take a look and kind of see where things are going. Like, it's a really cool program.
So yeah, I guess that wraps up our podcast episode for this week.
Yeah.
So, next week it's going to be another, movie club episode. And hopefully Robert will also join us. So
yeah, so we can have that whole the Superman Goku discussion.
It's gonna be Superman Krillin discussion.
Oh yeah, Superman Krillin. Sorry, maybe
Yamcha and Batman.
Throw him into
in types of martial arts.
Oh my god, tag team battle.
Also, what's happening this week is that every week, we're going to have In the Zone in our YouTube channel. Our episode 2 just recently got out yesterday. it's a bit late because we kind of have, you know, some dudes who's holding
timing
out
issues.
On links. But yeah, we got contributed links, yo. So we got
good. Nice. Very nice.
Yeah, and episode 3 is going to come out probably late this week also. So, expect for more gaming moments from In the Zone.
In the Zone.
Anyway, guys, thanks for listening, and see you next week in OGF Radio.
Bye, guys.